I'm palming the video. It's a palmonade. Okay. Global emperor to use religious conservatives. Global emperor to use religious conservatives. Religious conservatives. And that might be whom? I had a dream back in London in 1971. And in that dream, I saw four things above the podium of the global emperor or dictator or something like that. Now, you might think, huh, big deal, after all, dreams really are not all that serious. Are they? Well, maybe there's nothing to it. Maybe there's nothing to it. It's only that this dream was so jarring and so realistic and at the same time symbolic, really symbolic, that I remember it to this day. By the way, it was one of those color dreams, you know. They were religious objects hung over the podium of this dictator as a form of symbolic, obviously religious, huge symbols on a banner. There was a cross, a six-pointed star, a crescent, and a beast or animal with two horns. It appeared to be something like a bull's head. Now, what I would tend to read into this, if there was anything to it, and maybe there is, who knows, but what I would read into it at this point is those symbols represent religious symbologies. There was a cross, a six-pointed star, a crescent, and what appeared to be a bull's head. It's fairly obvious, perhaps, that these would tend to represent the majority-style conservative-type fundamentalism in all the world's major religions. There were the three monotheistic religions, and the fourth might have been a kind of a kind of union of all the world's polytheistic religions. You have to realize that polytheism comprises quite a few believers out there. Now, I know here we seem to be getting into the hazy grounds of what is termed, inverted commas, you ready for this one again, quote-unquote, theology. But I consider theology to be a science. Just like the relatively unknown scientific discipline of the study of miracles. Well, actually, it's not that unknown. Tomatology, the study of miracles. You know. Now, the common concept of theology is what clergy study before they can be ordained, and blah, blah, blah. and on they go, losing it all in somebody's misconception of religious ritualism. But actually, theology is supposed to be a scientific discipline, like biology, chemistry, physics, and so on. It's just that apparently it has never been treated as a discipline. You know, they probably try to jam it in with the humanities, you know. So they're going to take their motorboats down to Florida and hew some manatees. In other words, as a scientific discipline, theology would be, in a way, the science of humankind's functional relationship with the unexplainable realities and human interaction with probable superior intelligence. You may be one of those who jump to the convenient, self-comforting conclusion that the concept of superior intelligence is simply a superstition, or at best, the type of fiction relegated to the UFO crazes. But my conclusion is that it's safe to say that the jury is still out on that one. But whatever theology is, and however many imposters and charlatans there might be imposing themselves in the discipline of theology, you know, it's like you know, those hoaxes that appear in the I'm not even going to go there right now. Let's stick with this. Whatever theology is, and however many imposters and charlatans there might be imposing themselves in the discipline of theology, it must necessarily depart from humankind's concept of religion. Religion is the opposite of theology. Religion becomes the historic tool in the hand of politics, especially the type of politics involving authoritarian rule and dictatorship. Religion is the historic device politicians use to get the will of the people on their side. And that certainly has to be true with the imperial, with imperial rule and dictatorship, you know, relating to emperors. There is no empire without an indigenous religion to assign authority to that emperor and his or her empire. Well, check it out. Check it out. History is rife with these patterns. Therefore, you can extend the postulation to involve the ultimate empire. A global empire. Fortunately, I'm sure there will be no Star Wars. At least not with human beings. Man is... Anyway. A global empire. A global emperor, therefore, uses all global religions. Yeah. Now, therefore, it extends that there will have to be a polyglot here of religions. Somehow, they have to get them to kind of, if they're not going to cooperate, at least corroborate, you know. That's a global emperor uses all global religions. The founding fathers of the United States seemed to have tried to avoid this inevitability. Apparently, they recognized it as a part of dictatorship. They may have recognized that any human attempt at theocracy would only end up in some abuse that would lead to a dictator. And isn't that the inevitability of the pattern of history involving any theocracy? And also, by the way, just about every dictatorship. So the United States is supposed to have a separation of religion from the body politic. All that to say this, all I can say is, nice try. Nice try, man. You can't shake human nature that easily. It's like, okay, you know, Benjamin Franklin saw this little decoration on Washington's chair as he presided over the Constitutional Convention. It was a sun, and he, Franklin couldn't tell whether the sun was rising or setting. He said, you know, symbolically, you know how Franklin used to, you know, he was a big hit with the French back there in Versailles. But anyway, he said, finally, he said, oh, I'm sure that it's rising. Yes, the sun also rises. Oh, man, you ain't seen nothing yet, folks. You just hang on for this one. So, all I can say is nice try. It seems to be ingrained in human nature, and on a deeper level, there is another sort of devious human behavior that seems to be able to manipulate it. Okay, copy on that? It seems to be ingrained in human behavior, and on a deeper level, there is inevitably another sort of devious human behavior that seems to be able to manipulate it. The one characteristic of religion is to use, you know, well, let's put it this way. The one characteristic of religion is the use of formality and symbolism and ritual to achieve comfort and a false sense of security. Now, to cover it up, a lot of the church-state separationists, who are really protagonists of global dictatorship, are pretending to be watchdogs and are barking away at the slightest infringement of so-called religious artifacts and objects being proffered or displayed on state property or federal property or prayers in governmental functions and so on. Check it out for yourself, but I think you'll find that their real objective is also to, in the interim, keep ethics, often paralleled in monotheistic religions, from impairing personal interests, particularly those of the establishment of global empire, whose establishers and tenants must needs use deceit and subterfuge to get into power. I mean, you know, they gotta fool people, you know? I mean, people are so easily fooled. Religious institutions are easily infiltrated. Ritual can be expertly imitated by any imposter, tricking an average parishioner into imagining such an imposter to be extremely devout. But still in all, they're not going to willingly forfeit their democracy and their freedom and just let somebody walk right in and take over and boss them around. But as I said before, the pattern of history is a period of relative freedom or liberty followed by a subsequent abuse of mercantilism. Are you getting this? You know, which we are seeing now on a global scale. It's like $45 trillion worth of monetary value just disappears during the greatest recession of all history. Do you believe that? Man, you talk about abuse of mercantilism. They're starting to get pretty good at it, right? Okay, so there's this abuse of, as I said before, it's a pattern of history, is a period of relative freedom or liberty followed by a subsequent abuse of mercantilism, which we are seeing now on a global scale, inevitably followed by a dictatorship. Those that abuse liberty get busted by a dictator. That's history, man. It's history. That's not my opinion. It's history. You know, you're entitled to your opinion, kid, but that doesn't change reality. Look it up. Check it out. They get busted by a dictator. Check it out, man. Some of these dictators had to be pretty extensive, pretty involved, pretty, I don't know. It's like you had, like Alexander the Great, for example, or, he replaced Darius, you know. I'm talking about big time here. But but this time, as you can see, this time, democracy in the world is very well organized, and it is going to take subterfuge and deceit on the part of the unscrupulous, who apparently at this point seem to be within striking distance of pulling this off, as well as the use of religions. All religions whose people will apparently be manipulated by infiltrators in their midst to put the will of the people on the side of a global dictator.
Thank you.
Chairman Mao. Chairman Mao. Chairman Mao. Mao, 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 Mao. Yes, folks, what brought you to Garbage Mountains in the Western world? It's hails back to Emperor Qin and the United States of Asia and the wall that kept out the Mongolian tribes. Yes, and then the dynasties that finally ended up in the long march that defeated Chiang Kai-shek. There's a checkmate. Yes, folks, it hails back to Maoism and Chairman Mao that led to the synthesis that Marx was talking about. Marxi and his friend Engels, the rich kid from the folks at the fabric factory. Okay, so it hails back. Hails back like a Mac in the shack. What you got here now, they're able to overlook the transgressions of the deputies. Boys will be boys, girls will be girls. Put it in the blender and give it a whirl. Then the batteries of intelligentsia, subsidized in the back room somewhere, began to churn out the adaptation. And it ended up, yes, folks, just ship them their garbage mountains. They don't care. They have the turbulent flow, the cash flow, the goods flowing. They have the unitized freight, and they just can't wait to bake the cake and cause the quake. It hails back like a Mac in the shack to Mr. Mao, who taught them how. Over and out. The world would like to help you. The entire planet would like to see to your needs. We know you have global warming. We know you're approaching a water crisis. You're inundated with garbage. Most of it is in the form of hydrogen hydroxide or water in various products, going into the landfills of the developed world. We know that the whole planet Earth, the girth of the Earth, would like to respond. But as you can see, for the moment, they are stoned. They are stoned on the most popular designer drug ever known to man. Cash sheesh. And they're all out there smoking the local weed of cashish. Cashish Alex Ababalav. Brought to you by Bugului and his Yahoo Bugongos. Yes, folks, it's cashish. Otherwise known as cash, liquid, freak, spending change. Bunny money. Yes, sir, folks. They're all out there kissing butt for another hit of cashish. They're smoking it. They got it in the hookahs. They got it around the corner. They got it in their commuter dash. They got it in their television set sunsets, their high-density electronic wizardry. It's immersed in the robot vomit on the other side of the Manhattan rivers. Cashish. They're all too stoned to respond for the moment. And perhaps they never will. Didn't work. Got it. Put that out of there. All right. Where's this side? Last lady to give me a haircut. Made this side of my beard bigger than that side. Why, I don't know. Maybe she figured out it was more aesthetic or something like that. Anyway, no news is bad news. Contrary to what popular opinion dictates, yes, no news is bad news. The inevitability of the military-industrial complex to perpetuate war. When the media gets to the point that they stop giving news of the day, watch out. Watch out. That's really the end of the world. At least you're part of it. At least in your part of it, that's really the end of the world. And I'm not talking about Pavarazzi news or gossip columns. If Martha Stewart had been sent to Danbury low-level security prison for 5 months, I'll tell you, they would have had one of the most beautiful gardens in the world overall. They would have had the most beautiful gardens in the world. Move over, Versailles. Auf Wiedersehen, Pommengarten. Pommengarten. As a young teen back in the early 1960s, I remember riding the school bus to the old Danbury High and rolling past the Danbury Pen. You know, low-level security prison there, Danbury, Connecticut, where the rich usually ended up, mostly. Watching those rich inmates planting their gardens in the sunrise. That is reputed to be a very posh prison. But, yeah, that's not news. You know, I mean, we've heard about Martha Stewart going to prison, you know, the famous home expert, you know, and she ended up, you know, acting on a tip on a stock deal that landed her in prison for a few months. You know, the news was, in her case, they sent her to a tough prison. But, you know, it's the news you don't hear about. The inverted commas, quote unquote, the no news, hyphenated word there. I mean, we're not talking the Shawshank Redemption here. They could have put her in a mild prison with low-level security. You know, and you have to wonder why, you know. So did they, were they afraid Martha Stewart would try to escape? Oh, what the heck? Back when I was an information specialist in the Army Material Command in Building T-7 in Virginia, about 5 miles from the Pentagon, I found out the military-industrial complex needed a large enough theater of armed conflict to be going on and on perpetually as an economic engine to fuel their guaranteed employment and steady income. Now, that's news. Because it has been happening since ancient Egypt and will continue to go on until the final, total news blackout never lets you know anything's happening. My investigation uncovered extensive parties with vested interest in the continuation of conflict. And when the U.S. stopped sending U.S. service personnel to the Vietnam theater of conflict, you know, the yellow and red badge, they replaced them with South Vietnamese personnel. Eisenhower warned about this, but back then we erroneously assumed it to be the paranoia of an old man. Sorry, Ike. Sorry, Ike. You were right. We should have known better. So now, there is a potential candidate for a new perpetual war scenario. Is it or isn't it? Is it a free nation willing to share the American Revolution with others in need? Or is it the same military-industrial complex up to its old tricks again? Well, maybe we should know, but maybe only time will tell. Anyway, the red flags are up all over the place. It's like the ancient Greek story of Jason passing the island of the armament makers. Day and night, the forges glowed, and they worked without rest around the clock. The lesson is clear. Beware countries producing armaments for sale. They don't care where the battlefield is, as long as they're rich. It could be in your backyard next time. Shouldn't they be stopped, you ask? If you're wondering that right about now, my response would have to be this. What's the matter? Didn't you take history in high school? Didn't you take world history in high school? These guys are filling a slot. That's why they seem so ordinary at first. They conform to the pattern. They get bigger and bigger until they go global. What? Did you just think they would go away? When they run out of stooges, they could just use the guy next door to you if necessary. Hey, they could just pick up the guy next door, for crying out loud. You know? Fill the slot. You know, and this is like 2004, second Gulf War. The first Gulf War was brief. It's like, was it the 90s still? But that could have been for the purpose of getting you ready for the second one with Bush number two. But first, the first one actually was kind of mini world war. Yep, it was just kind of on a technicality, it was a world war. The second in 2004, an armed conflict or sort of police action. Certain pieces of the puzzle fit. Letting the bulk of Hussein's army escape. Allowing weapon caches and ammo dumps to be looted completely. Going lax on surveillance on the borders of the country. And so on. Next thing, if the scenario fits, and that's really the situation, there'll be another Ho Chi Minh Trail bombed by B-52s. Only this time, it'll go by a different name. You know, so, yeah, Ho Chi Minh Trail opened up. Hindsight, you know. One of them was a well-pounded trail through from Syria. The other one from Iran. You know. Oh, it's the bad guys. Oh, man. You want to play the bad guy card. It's just pathetic. Okay, so what the dark side of the military-industrial complex needs is another Vietnam War. The last one, the real Vietnam conflict back in the mid-20th century, the Australians got out of the loop. They thought they were supposed to win. They almost foiled the continuum back in the 60s. But they were held back and then hit with the psych stuff. Yeah, I know because I had a chance to talk to them. I lived in Australia for a while. The more global the quote-unquote continuum gets, the closer history gets to the whatchamacallit. The whatchamacallit. No, not the end of the world. That would be too facile. We'll cross that bridge if we come to it. But notice how the possible continuum managed to keep older empires out of the works. France and Germany. Once again, remember that there are lots of gray areas and blurry edges here. You know, maybe that's what's happening, or maybe it's something else. Just so you know what to look for, if this isn't it, and the real thing comes along. But if you're hearing this, and you've just might be involved, and you are one of the elite, all I can say is So you think you're the great world leadership, the continuum of the day. What can I say? You're just the latest raw hamburger on the grill of the constantly repeating patterns of history. My advice is, get out of that business. Better to be on the street with your empty cup, bumming spare change, than to be one of those guys. With all the coercion that goes on, you'll never have your own mind. Get out of that business, buddy, while you can. Okay. You want café au lait? Well, better au lait than never. That's supposed to be a trumpet, the Mariachi band. Rubber band. Oh, remember that? That's to be Mr. Spaceman. You don't remember that? That's it. That was a hit from the 50s, along with the Purple People Eater. Oh, Mr. Spaceman, I think you're really with it. Actually, it was Mr. Bassman, but I thought it was Mr. Spaceman, because all those pop songs, they seem to be so childish. They were, they discovered that most people had this childish mentality when it came to music, and the way to make big bucks was to do kids' music, zit music. It's simplistic stuff, Great balls of fire. It's little, kids' music. It's like we used to listen to that kind of stuff on the 78s with like little yellow records we put on there, and we used to decorate it with crayons until we found out it affected the sound quality, what little there was. Kids stuff, man. All right, anyway. So, ole. Okay. Bingo, ball, and booze. Bingo, ball, and booze. Yeah. I can almost remember the town in England. Almost. I mean, I'm still trying to remember where it is, I spent a lot of time in that place, on the streets out there. It was somewhere in the burbs, in the south part of London. In the suburbs. Almost remember, but not quite. I should have kept a diary. But that's the problem with traveling light, at least in those days, Maybe now I could leave it in the blogosphere as I go. I was on the street selling underground newspapers. As I used to say, underground and coffee ground. man, you gotta have a joke. You gotta laugh. Laughter keeps you through this stuff. Forget religious ritual. Laughter is the way to go, man. Laughter. You've got to be hanging from the laughters. Anyway, underground and coffee ground. The best thing about being on the... Oops. I got to pick up. I'm sorry. This ought to be good. Ah. I have to use the landline because my cell phone fell down the air conditioner duct. Hello? Hello? Got an ant on the phone. It's a fax. You know, now I got to get put up with junk calls, and this is a fax. Tell them it's not over till the fax lady sings. Oh, man. Now I got to leave that landline plugged in. You know, the phone fell down to the next floor. Well, I could tell you about it, but yeah, it's trivia. La triviata. Da, 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 whatever it is. Okay, where were we? Oh, yeah. All right, coffee ground and underground. Man, you know, like, I could make about $25 a day with my underground newspapers, but at least I'm self-employed. You know, when you're self-employed, you can work below the minimum wage. It's the only time it's really worth it. You know, you call your own shots, you know. Shotzi line. Okay. So, the best thing about being on the street is you can, as Woody Guthrie used to put it, quote-unquote, touch the people, meaning you could get out there and meet folks. I used to think I must have spoken with a million people in my 20 years of travel, but perhaps a more conservative estimate would be I don't know, 300,000. It adds up, man. You talk to people personally on the street all the time, every day. I mean, if you value people, you're going to get out there and talk, you know, meet them, talk with them, you know. So, it's about 300,000, maybe a million. It adds up. But as far as personally contacting people, for example, everyone that heard me sing on the street and that I got to say hi to, well, that's over 1 million, you know. That's over, but, you know. Anyway, so one evening I remember, and here's some of the value of that. It's what you pick up, man. I remember an elderly English gentleman stopped to talk with me about what he called the three B's. The three B's. He kept insisting that I remember the method the government, and now this was in England, mind you, the method the government controlled the masses with was the three B's. Bingo, ball, and booze. I mean, you never know. You never know. I might have been talking with somebody who simply enjoyed bantering conspiracy theories about, or he might have been the equivalent of a retired James Bond or something, you know. So he asked me to repeat it a few times. Pardon me, I'm getting repetitive stress problems from peering at the desktop, the laptop screen. Oh, man. Got a permanent crick in my neck for the last 2 years here. Okay, but, hey, it's a good tool. So, anyway. So, the three B's. He asked me to repeat it a few times. So that's how he was able, in a way, to make sure It got at least as far as this little vid I'm making right now. Something like 40 years later. So it worked. The gentleman knew what he was doing. At the time, I imagined it unlikely that the governance of any nation would have to go to such lengths to install a crowd control safeguard. I mean, the industries themselves were big enough. Why should any political entity want a finger in the pie? You know, check out these industries. Gambling, alcohol, and sports. You kidding me? Now, why would any political entity want a finger in that pie? But as I started to visit other parts of England, now this is just a typical example, a country among many, and what they resort to, if this is true. And let's check it out. But as I started to visit other parts of England, I began to see some evidence that the three B's might actually be in effect. Once I remember looking for a bathroom in a city somewhere up north. I was given permission at the door of a large motion picture theater, the kind with huge screens that they used to have somewhere back in the 50s. So now I'm given permission to use the bathroom in there. So as I was going through the deserted lobby on the way to the facilities, I heard this bizarre chanting sound echoing throughout the actual theater, and a more bizarre high-pitched sound, you know, that seemed to come from everywhere, and thinking it to be some strange ritualistic event going on, and since there was no one around, I resolved to scamper up the carpeted steps a bit to take a little peek. And I had a bird's eye view. The auditorium, arranged in the typical amphitheater sort of setting with a loge, orchestra, and balcony seating in front of a stage, was absolutely filled, chockers, chock-a-block, filled with people. Or to be more precise, ladies. All more or less in their later years. The high-pitched sound came from televisions. I don't know if you remember, you just turn on the TV, you'd wait for it to warm up. I could tell when the TV was warming up, it started to make this high-pitched sound. Like that, you know. I don't know if you guys listened to that sound first. Most people would just not notice it, I guess. But it came from televisions. Hundreds of them. Hundreds of them. Very large ones for their day. Positioned at regular intervals throughout the entire seating arrangement. The whole place was very dimly lit, except for a spotlight trained on center stage, where there was this enormous ping-pong ball-style randomizer of clear glass or plastic. And even from my vantage point, one could see the balls whirling around inside under the power of an internal blower of some sort. I mean, it's not uncommon anymore. You see them all the time in those lottery drawings on television. I don't know if they still have them, but, you know, they used to be a big deal. When it was the lottery time, the ping pong balls would pop up. Oh, hi, little buddy. What you doing? Here, you go on that little, you go on my little old lady thing. A cute little pet beetle. There you go. Come on, buddy. See? That little beady the beetle, huh? He's such a little friend. Hi, buddy. How are you? You going over there, okay? The amazing little guy. I dusted him off. There he goes, taking off. Bye-bye, buddy. I dusted him off the shelf under the air conditioner the other day because I thought it was a big bead of dust. It was, you know, the little beetle. And so, but as he went down to the ground in midair, he took flight. Happy ending. He was over there somewhere. Cute little guy. Yeah, keeps me company here. Okay, so let's see. Now, this I wrote this in 2003. I don't know if they still have those ping pong things. It must be, you know, a hangover from the ping pong dynasty. But anyway, you used to see them all the time in those lottery drawings on television, you know, randomizing device. The sequence of names appearing on ballots throughout California. You know, if such a device was used to randomize the sequence of names appearing on ballots throughout California during the impromptu election that recalled Governor Gray Davis, that was in September of 2003. And I actually had a chance to vote on that in that thing. It was unbelievable. In my travels, for one brief moment, I was a citizen of California. That happened throughout my periodic world travels. Anyway, long story short. Oops, what's going on? Okay, it's your dime. I remain incommunicado. Hello? Oh, now I'm getting somewhere. Tell them it's not over till the fax lady sings. I put the phone back on the hook, you know. Ah. So, that's the end of that. Now the phone's going to be, you know, it would ring every 5 minutes. So I'm going to have to just pull the plug on that baby. Okay. So you see what I'm getting to here? You know, this was you know, what I'm saying is that in each electoral district, I believe it is, that had the names of hundreds of people that anteed up for the privilege of running for the governor, running for governor if Gray Davis was recalled in that time, when Davis was recalled in that time, it was printed in different random order so that no name would continually come first, you know. They had to resort to that because of human behavior. The human being, look, when you quote-unquote Google something, can you, you know, you get a, you, so let's say you get 10 million. Oh, 10 million in 0.25 of a second, aren't we good? Yeah, then you see Google with a lot of O's in there. would you want to be able to check out, like, the 9,523rd entry in there? You couldn't possibly. It would take you probably about 10 months, 24/7 or so, to Google up to that 9 millionth entry. Let's say, I don't know. Oop. I'm going to have to deal with this. Hey, I'm able to deal with this, and I don't even have a deck of cards. I'll just toss that phone down the air conditioner duct. It would be called be a prod duct, wouldn't it? There might be a quack in the armory. I don't know. I think maybe they ruined this video. I'm not quite sure if the headset works anymore. There's no way to really check it out. I'm going to probably have to reshoot this. I hate to do that. There's no time for rehearsal in this stuff. Okay. So, in my district, the first two names on the ballot were both of them were Schwarzenegger. Until then, I thought there to be only one in that race. So I don't know, Schwarzer baby made it first in my district, so who knows. Anyway, to get back to this, there they were, a whole theater full of people, mostly ladies it seemed, transfixed by the gleaming ping-pong randomizer on stage. Regularly, a well-dressed gentleman would take the most recent ball as it slid down the transparent tube and out into a sort of trough, and then announce the letter and number imprinted on it to the waiting crowd in a low, droning voice that echoed throughout the auditorium on loudspeakers in front, in back, and on the sides. I just stared at this, and then remembered about the three B's. Even if it weren't on purpose, this was big. This was big, man. It is conceivable that something that enormous could happen by itself. I mean, with something popular. You know, that popular, it had to be a big business. But if someone wanted to control the segment of the population that didn't go for sports and might be absolute teetotalers, this was it. This was it. I stared at the crowd of attentive ladies. Not an empty seat in the house. With a pastime like this, There wouldn't be time for social protestation or any other project. The government was safe, at least for the time being. I mean, you know, even if it was an accident, it was a convenience for the government. They were safe. No more suffragettes out on the street. At least for the time being, they would just sit there. They would just sit there for hours, waiting for the next ping pong ball to emerge, one at a time. Wow. These would be the hardest to control. They would have to have the most powerful of all the big three. The bingo bee. The first in the triptych. You know, how would you control them? They would be the hardest to control. Of course, you'd have to use the biggest bee you got. You'd have to play your trump card. The bingo bee. Oh man. And don't think it was confined to just England. What is it with this game? I remember once in Eastern Samoa, on the other side of the planet, on a beautiful weekend day, I think it was Saturday, I had to find someone at the public market. Now, the public market was in the capital, Pango Pango, you know. You may think this is some exotic, off-the-wall place out in the middle of the ocean or something, but think again. Pango Pango is the location of the deepest natural harbor in the world. It is the crossroads of the Pacific. At least when I was there back in 1978, it's a big stop-off place for container ships who use its facility as a sort of transfer point, causing a great container skyscraper to cut into the tropical skyline. I used to take pictures of it, you know, the hell, tourist attractions. This was really something. That and the, you know, the fish packing plant there, the, let's see, the United States tuna fishing fleet was based out of Pango Pango, along with the Korean tuna fishing fleets. You know, you have to cap. You have to punctuate reality with a apostrophe. I'll tell you. If nothing else, buddy, you're going to get a big laugh out of, you know, out of what's going on. It's like so preposterous. Anyway, back to our regularly scheduled program. It was a big stop-off place for container ships, you know. Even though it may not look like much at first glance, it is. It's just that it's dwarfed by the volcanic mountains around it. I mean, you know, formidable landscape there. Way in the back, see this tiny little, oh yeah, look at those containers, man. A fairly modern cable car spans the entire bay. At the time, I don't know if it still is. It was home or base, at least, of one of the home bases of the American tuna fishing fleet, state of the art back then, and several Korean tuna fishing fleets. They have a modern airport that accommodates international jumbo jets from continents and oceans away. That was back in the days of Pan Am. You remember when they still thought that Pan Am might be able to, you know, like have a shuttle to the moon, you know, in your dreams, buddy. Anyway, so when I went to find that person, I expected to see a huge marketplace bustling with activity, but they had shut the place down. It shut down the entire market. You know, they had shut the place down, and what appeared to be thousands of people were sitting on the pavement, you guessed it, playing bingo.
There once was a man who had a dog, and Bingo, Bingo was his name. There was an old man who had a dog, and Bingo was his name. B-I-N-G-O, 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 and Bingo was his name.
Bingo, you know. It's like, that's how Harry Crosby got his stage name. He used to be a paper boy, and he was such a good shot at getting that newspaper right on the people's steps as he whizzed past on his, like, you know, one-speed bicycle in those days. When he was a kid, paper boy, he got the nickname Bingo. And that's how he came to be called Bing Crosby. Yep, it was Bingo Crosby, the best shot with a wadded-up paper newspaper on the block. But these guys were out there thousands. They shut down the marketplace. Unbelievable. You never see that happen. Never. And there are exceptions. Crowd control. Well, I don't know whether that was, you know. Anyway, I'll tell you. And they were playing bingo. Lane after lane of the normally busy, I mean busy, market. The entire area, the equivalent of 5 or 6 city streets, loudspeakers blaring at regular intervals. People were attentively playing bingo. Bingo. Now, if people want to play that all day long, that's their choice. It is kind of fun. I thought it might be more interesting to try different words like existentialist or anti-disestablishmentarianism. But maybe that wouldn't work. Someone got the winning formula when they came up with the name Bingo. They started us out early in life singing about the old man who owned Bingo the dog. Best damn advertising jingle they ever came up with. If they did. If they did. Whoever they are. Probably it was just a cute song. You know, I mean, if somebody did that on purpose, that would really be a real scandal, you know. Oh, yeah, actually, that cute song, Bingo the Dog, it was really, crowd control effort on the part of the subterfuge brought to you by Cutesy and Bootsy. Nope. Bingo was his name. But have you ever noticed how seriously, you know, these guys take it? You ever notice that? I mean, it's a kid's game, for crying out loud. It's a kid's game. Why bingo? What about Slinky, or Silly Putty, or Old Maids, or Snakes and Ladders? Maybe even a more grown-up game like Checkers. No, it had to be bingo. You know, that was the winner. And man, did it catch on. Whether the man with the 3 B's was spot on or not, it sure looked like there was something going on. Something more going on, at least, than meets the eye. You know? But even if not, bingo could go it alone. It could take over the world all by itself. But the players take it so seriously. This is the advantage of world travel. You see the parallels going on here in human nature. Man, it's like two diametrically different cultures, and they're playing the same game. The players take it so seriously. When I found the person in the market that I was looking for, the only comment was, you know, that my clothes were unkempt. I mean, come on. Here I was at this miscarriage of human potential, and they were worrying about my PR presentation. You know, that's where I had to draw the line. That's where I drew the line. It had to be it had to be institutionalized. Nobody was having any fun. It had to be institutionalized. It had to be something behind it. That's where I drew the line, man. I mean, you know, they were under control. It's got to be. Well, after that, I sort of forgot to check in an area if bingo had spread to their land, or if these other countries had something else going on or what. I sort of like, I wasn't about to become, like a bingo detective. It's like Vermont, though. It's like, I get word from my brother-in-law. The mother-in-law has visited. Well, where is she? She's not here. She's out. She was out somewhere playing bingo. I said, you don't even have to go looking for this. Bingo will come to your block. So I sort of like lost my enthusiasm for my bingo, investigation type. I didn't do it on purpose anyway. Excuse me, I'm getting desert throat. Okay. But something really powerful is going on to prevent the section of the population that isn't neutralized by the other two Bs. And those guys, they're hopeless. If once they walk down the dark side of the farce, the twisted paths of ball and booze, just write them off as goners. Easy shots, piece of cake. I'm not talking about the poor closet drinkers here. At least they have an excuse. Something else wiped their slate. But what about those who really pose a problem to the sort of institution that would prefer the remnant, the most serious segment that could really do something if left to their devices, under the provincial or the proverbial thumb of state control? You know, So I'm trying to wax eloquent here. Basically, you know, what kind of thing would cause this, to be, you know, like the most serious segment that could really do something, some damage if they, you know, like we're going to, what would bring them under the control of this, you know, of this, probable state control, if there was such a thing, you know. then you've got to have, you know, the ultimate weapon, you know, to get the other status quo threatening 1/10 of the population who escaped unscathed. You know, if you want to get them, you know, you have to pull out your ultimate weapon here, you know. It's like, who ever thought it? A gambling device from a kid's game. But it worked. That's all she wrote. Curtains. It must be the end of the world for sure. There was an old man who had an old dog, and Bingo was his name. Man, you can't lose with a watchdog like that. You know, I remember it back in the 90s? I think it was, or the early part, the zeros, the early part of the 21st century. The dictator of this conglomerate nation called Iraq, which was really the invention of the imperial powers of the early 20th century and late 19th century. You know, Lawrence of Arabia was livid. He tried to warn them and said, you know, leave it alone. You're supposed to, it is not Iraq. What you've got is Mesopotamia there. You're supposed to leave. If they had left it alone, we wouldn't have had the problem. So here we have the neo, Foreign Legion having to go in, traipse around, and deal with Sadr and Hussein and all these other guys. So this dictator Saddam Hussein at that time, I don't know if any of you remember that, you know, they actually, in order to get in there and invade his regime, they invented this story that he was trying to buy uranium from certain areas like south of Africa to build nuclear bombs, you know. Well, forget trying to find out if Hussein tried to buy uranium in Africa. Forget the nukes. There's something far more sinister afoot out here. And there's only one solution. Regime change. Yes, the ultimate solution. Regime change. B-10, I-9, N-8, G-7, O-6, 5-4-3-2-1, apocalypse. That wasn't good enough. That was that was a howitzer. How about this one? That's the beginning of a nuclear bomb, but I can't really go into it because I'm worried I'd get a sore throat. Ooh! No, that's a dinosaur throat. We don't want one of those. That'd be worse, huh? Okay. Yeah, it's like, I saw this one, this huge skyscraper out there, and that was a dino eyesore. I said, oh, I wonder what kind of glycemious age that came from. Okay. You could probably tell I was kidding, but the Bingo thing is sort of incredible. I have to admit, you know, the Bingo thing was sort of incredible. So let's get serious for a minute here. in all our stories and works of fiction in our literary world, we look for the bad guys. In fact, I notice in the terminology creeping into the military, they're using that term too. Well, we're talking about the bad guys, you know. It's like, it may be a public relations ploy or just an unconscious reaction. They're the bad guys. Get them. They may be or not. Or partially or completely. When you make blanket statements, you lose some of the effect if you have to go defining terms. I would be defining the terms, but if you have to go to define the terms, you can lose some of the effect. In the real world, it's not the good guys who cause things to work out. In the real world, now let's get down to this. The real world is the good guys who cause even more problems than the villains. Something just happened in the human condition to make us that way. But the bad guy thing is so, the bad guy thing is compounded by willful ignorance. So what is the greatest cause of global poverty, wars, political unrest, even catastrophic plagues and all sorts of other extreme failings in society? The disinterest of the common person. The disinterest of the common person. The everyday person in pursuit of disconnecting amusements, such as gambling, social drinking, or worst of all, professional sports. That's right, buddy. It was guys like you who caused World War II. That's a good one. Blame it on Hitler, huh? Blame it on Hitler. Meanwhile, there's the president throwing out the first baseball of the season. Tell me about it. The bottom line, I hate to use that, I don't want to be a bottom liner, but I gotta say, the bottom line here is, if the three B's come into play in your world, then you're a part of the cause. You're a part of the problem. Because you don't give a damn. You don't give a damn. Oh, you claim you can indulge yourself and still get on with doing a good job, but you're kidding yourself. It's a front. It's all a good show. No substance. No professionalism. Just enough to squeak by. A waste of a life. A waste of a contribution. You want baseball? Go out and play some softball with the neighbors. So somebody can throw a ball. You want to make him a millionaire? No wonder so much money is tied up and going nowhere. So you guys can just sit around and feel rich. You know, those guys can just sit around and feel rich. It's the cheapest mind control there is. And you're the stooge. So go ahead, waste a life. Just so you know. Just so you know, it's irresponsible. And not just that. It's the cause of the problem. Yet nobody dares to look at it. No one dares bring the cancer into the light. Do you know why? Because they're scared. Yeah, they're scared too. They're scared of you. Does that make you feel good? Yeah, I bet it does. Hey, whatever happened to Enron Stadium, huh? You probably forgot about that. That's a real one for you. What a bunch of creeps. Well, guess what, wise guy? This is the planet of death. The planet of death. You people made it that way with your little games. Just one of the crowd. Too many wars. A lot of people died. And for what? They died so you could have the freedom to act responsibly and do your part. So, what are you doing with it? Sitting around blowing paycheck after paycheck on the slots? Wasting your time off watching someone else play a game? Hanging out at the watering hole, staring at a swizzle stick all night? Yeah. Go ahead. You don't care. Okay, so you're the bad guys. Huh? You always were, and you always will be. Till the inevitable world dictator shuts you down. Someday. And he won't need uranium from Africa to do it. All he'll have to do is help out the global poor and the starving. And they'll do anything for him. They already know. You don't care.